Okay, today I want to talk about small exotic Stein manifolds, and in particular I want to discuss my recent result with Eylem Zeliha Yildiz. So these are the results. There is a pair of compact contractible Stein four manifolds W1, W2, which are homeomorphic but not diffeomorphic to each other. Also, there's another theorem that I want to mention in here. There's a pair of compact Stein manifolds Q1, Q2, a homotopy equivalent to S1 plus B3, which are only same result, which are homeomorphic. But not diffeomorphic to each other. So this is the recent result with Eylem Zeliha Yildiz. Also, this the proofs of these results depend on the quarks, anti-quarks, and also some work with Rubenman, Danny Rubenman. First, I should tell you why small exotic manifolds are important. It's because we are in the hunt of trying to find are there exotic S4, S1 cross S3, S2 cross S2, and CP2. Right, so the copies of. Okay, so this will be a big prize. So we are seeking these manifolds on the classification of smooth 4 manifolds. And to do this, we first get exotic manifold. Exotic manifold pair means pairs that are homeomorphic but not diffeomorphic each other. Sometimes we call them absolutely exotic because there's no condition about relative condition about the boundary. So we apply these things. First, we find manifolds with boundaries that are exotic copies of each other, and then try to somehow compactify the boundaries. And where does Stein come in? Stein's property is the property from symplectic geometry or complex manifold theory. Once you put a Stein structure on a manifold, that there's a corresponding handle body described by Ali Eschberg's work, and then that makes the handles very tight. In the sense that, for instance, if you have a Stein manifold boundary S3. Then Ali Eschberg says that you don't even have to say it is homotopy B4 in here. If you have such a manifold, it has to be 4-ball. If you have a Stein manifold bounded S1 cross S2, then again Ali Eschberg theorem says that it has to be S1 cross B3. So on the other hand, we want to find if there are exotic Stein manifolds as small as possible, and where is the transition from there to here, when once you have Stein manifolds, standard simple boundaries, they become standard 4 manifolds. But what are the exotic Stein manifolds? how simple can we make them so that we can approach towards these problems? So, in the, so the beginning point of this proofs is we start with quarks in here, anti-quarks in here. So let's just proof of theorem one. Let's discuss theorem one. So start with a quark WF. So a quark means a contractible smooth manifold. And the diffeomorphism on the boundary. So let me just call them V, because I'm going to use the letter W later on. V, so this is VF. So these are contractible homotopic point. So V is a contractible compact smooth manifold, and the diffeomorphism on the boundary, which does not extend diffeomorphism inside, but extends the homeomorphism inside. So these kind of things give relative exotic structures on V. One is the standard one, the other one the pulled by the homotopy, the homeomorphism. Because homotopy implies homeomorphism by Friedman's theorem. So you pull back the smooth structure by this homeomorphism H, and you get two smooth structures on V. Well, boundary, they are different. But we would like to get examples where this the two different manifolds, genuinely different, homeomorphic but not diffeomorphic. And we have proved in the past with Slava Matveev that if you have a quark, so this quark is something with that property, we can make, we can make this quark Stein, in fact. So that's an extra niceness property of a quark. So we, in fact, gave definition of a quark is a pair manifold, a manifold with a diffeomorphism on the boundary, contractible manifold diffeomorphism on the boundary, and we made the assumption, we made the rule that this manifold should be Stein, because if you don't have a non-Stein manifold, we can turn into, by manipulating this, turn into Stein. Stein is a nicer property. So the quark is a contractible Stein manifold, diffeomorphism on the boundary, which extends homeomorphism, but not diffeomorphism. So this is a standard starting point of this proof. Okay, so the in this proof, we use a recent result of Eylem Yildiz. So let me just put her theorem in here. Theorem Yildiz. Any knot K in S1 cross S2 in the homotopy class. S1 cross a point is concordant. Concordant to it. Okay, so this is a pretty result. It says that if you have a K in S1 cross S2, so this is S1 cross S2 cross I, if this knot is homotopic to S1 cross point, you can find a concordance to S1 cross point. Okay. So if you look at, in fact, her theorem works like here's an example. Here's an example of a knot in the homotopic, this homotopic S1 cross point, this is like this, a picture of S1 cross S2 on the boundary, which is actually is a formula for S1 cross B3. So it's a picture of this knot on the boundary, homotopic to S1 cross point. And it's clearly, if you are allowed to cross this knot itself, you can go from there to this this knot in here. This is S1 cross a point. Okay? So we see this by moving pictures, to crossing, and her point, her result is, if you have crossing like this, I can do crossing change by my moving pictures. Moving pictures, you know, you just approach this with an isotopy like this. Then you touch this point in here. Then by an isotopy, you go from here to there. So this, you change the crossing. So this thing is a chain crossing changed with a little circle in here. So you can hear concordance. So if you allow me, so this is starting with a K. I do moving pictures of this K. So I do this, and then you get a pair of circles. Like this. So a little circle breaks out, and the crossing changed. So if you can, if you do many times this operation, you can do any crossing change you want. At the end, you will end up a concordance from this knot to this S1 cross point, and then bunch of circles like this. See, this is the K. There's a picture of the K, K prime. K prime is real like this. This is like a K prime. And this is a little circle. It's a little circle. Normally you should get stuck because you are not able to find the, I want to find the concordance to this one, but this is the circle hanging in here. But in S1 cross S2, this is a picture on the boundary, S1 cross S2. This on the boundary, the circles bounded disks separate from in here. I mean, this picture is real. The alternative, this picture is this picture. If you like this, yes, this picture, gamma. These circles are these circles, like this. This circle bound, this circles bound disjoint disks. So these are this is one handle. You see different notation for that one. So there's a. Each circles bound disks without touching this gamma. So they, so you do this operation like this, and then a K prime, the knot you get by crossing, by doing crossing changes, and a bunch of circles, but they kept, like in here, they kept in S1 cross S2. So you get a concordance. One of the nice property of this concordance is if you take a look at this concordance. This concordance really invertible concordance. So this concordance observation. This concordance. So this is the this concordance, what I mean is in here, is an invertible. So it means, it follows from the proof, in fact. So here's S1 cross S2. Here's your knot. Let me just draw knot like a single point. S1 cross, this is S1 cross S2, and this is S1 cross S2 cross I. Two copies on here, and then this knot comes to here, S1 cross point. Invertible means if you just double this thing, this thing becomes same as just S1 cross S2, and then and you have S1 cross I in here. So when you double this concordance, it becomes standard. You might think, what has that got to do with the theorems you mentioned? One of the important part of the proof uses a fact like this. In fact, people who looked our paper with Ruberman, we use invertible concordances in S3, and they are hard to find in general part of our proof uses invertible concordances. But this Eylem's theorem gives you automatically any knot which goes algebraically once in S1 processor invertible coordinate standard one. So now you have a lot of choices to prove in the to use in the proof. So that's the idea. Let's now continue with the proof. Okay, so let's erase this. So I have V, and I have a diffeomorphism F. This is a quark. As I said, I can take this to be Stein. In fact, this quark is this one, like is this one, the one handle and two handle with zero framing. This is a Stein manifold. So we start with this manifold. It's a contractible manifold. The goal is to manipulate this to a Stein manifold, at the same time absolutely exotic manifold. So this is not this particular diffeomorphism doesn't extend, but after I manipulate both of them, I'll get a pair of manifolds which are homeomorphic but not diffeomorphic, at the same time simultaneously Stein. That's our goal. Okay, so the proof goes like this. Uses the important theorem, recent theorem by Paulus and Porti. These mathematicians are interested in symmetries of three manifolds, and there are many theorems about how to make manifolds symmetric. Three manifold symmetric. In other words, if you have like finite group, can you find this, realize it by a group of diffeomorphism of a three manifold? And their theorem is generalization of some previous theorems of Meyer, but it's the most sophisticated version of the theorem. It says that if Y is an orientable, is a closed orientable, three-manifold oriented, whatever, three-manifold, then there is a link in this three-manifold such that Y3 minus L has no symmetry and it is hyperbolic. So there's no periodic diffeomorphisms, and no, this is there's no this group of diffeomorphisms identity here, and also this link is hyperbolic. In fact, their theorem is much stronger than this. They can choose a link such that group of symmetries of this any finite group that you want. So, but this is the version we use this in here. So what has that got to do with this situation? So the diffeomorphism of this quark V is an involution. F is an involution. So what we would like to do is kill the symmetries. So this is a Z2 symmetry on the boundary of V. We want to kill this. So this is a technique I'm telling you that we use with Danny Rubinman to use this theorem to kill the symmetry on the boundary. So I might as well mention the proof of it. It's very nice. So so this is a boundary of this V here, the boundary of V is Y in here. Okay. So I apply Paulus and Porti theorem. I find the link. So this right link is L here. I find the link. The complement has no symmetry and complement is hyperbolic. Okay? So, so look at the tubular neighborhood of this link in here. So, for the sake of simplicity, I will assume this link is a knot. Actually, the version we are using is This link has at least four components, the one we are using. But never mind this. Just assume L is a knot living on the boundary of V with no symmetry. Now, what is this tubular neighborhood of this knot? So assume, for simplicity, L is a knot. So that's the tubular neighborhood of a knot, which is S1 cross D2. Okay. So what is S1 cross D2? What's that got to do with this one? Well, S1 cross D2, this thing is a complement of S1 cross point in S1 cross S2. I mean, tubular neighborhood of this one. Let's say call this standard here. Because this is a union of S1 cross D2, S1 cross D2, minus plus. So if you take this knot gamma in this case, gamma, trivial knot here in S1 cross S2, the complement is S1 cross D2. What I would like to do is I would like to make a cobordism such that this S1 cross D2 will be some knot complement of K S1 cross S2. So this is a trivial knot complement. This is a complement of trivial knot. So that's just trivial knot means S1 cross a point. So remove that complement of trivial knot in S1 cross S2 with complement of non-trivial knot S1 cross S2. So I need some kind of concordance to that. So I mean, this is K. We have every knot, according to Yildiz's theorem, every knot that algebraically going once in S1 cross S2 concordant to S1 cross a point. So what I would like to do is use that concordance to replace complement of trivial S1 cross point in S1 cross S2 with the complement of a non-trivial knot S1 cross S2. Okay? Such that this knot has no symmetry and hyperbolic. So find a knot K in S1 cross S2 in the homotopy class of S1 cross point with hyperbolic symmetry such that the complement is hyperbolic and no symmetry. Okay, so suppose I find such a knot. Suppose I found such a knot which goes algebraically once in on S1 cross S2, complement is hyperbolic and has no symmetry. And I started with a knot. Knot is a link right now. I'm making simple. I start with a knot in the boundary of V. Complement is hyperbolic, has no symmetry. But now I go, I find a knot in S1 cross S2 whose complement is hyperbolic, has no symmetry. These kind of things you do, you seek by computer. There are some theorems that tells you how to find this. Using like Snappy, you can use Snappy and Color, Dunfield, Gorner, Weeks, there's some of the names, and DHL, and there's a group of people. So there are computer programs that tells you how to search, given any knot in here, we are interested in the ones that are going algebraically once, check whether complements are hyperbolic, has any symmetry. So we want to find such a knot by using computer programs like this. DHL is Dunfield, Hoffman, Likata, and this Hikmot is Hoffman, Ichihara, Kashiwagi, Masai, Oishi, Takayoshi. Takayoshi. These are the group of people. They develop computer programs such a way that you can actually, using this computer program, applying this computer program to a knot, and then this, it will result the proof that this knot, complement of this has no symmetry and hyperbolic. So applying this, we find such a knot in S1 cross S2. So that's that knot. And I know every knot which goes algebraically once, it is concordant to S1 cross a point. So this was this is the unknot, complement of unknot in S1 cross S2. Now I have a complement of K in complicated knot in S1 cross S2. So this is the product in here. And in here, I use this concordance. So this part, so let's draw with color. The complement of this yellow in here is here, is the complement of unknot in here. Then you replace this this complement with the complement of this K. Here, this thing. So this is a complement of K in S1 cross S2. Yellow is the complement of S1 point in S1 cross point in S1 cross S2. So, and then what do I put in here? I just put this complement, C. This is C. Okay. So this is really, this is the S1 cross D2 is the complement of unknot. S1 cross P point inside of S1 cross S2. I'm replacing this with a complement of complicated knot S1 cross S2 using this concordance C. So now my the rest of this cobordism is just a product. And now I do same in here. Here. This is an L, and this is a K. Remember, this diffeomorphism was a Z2 symmetry, involution on the boundary of V. And there was, I found a knot or link by using Paolizzi-Porti, such a complement is no symmetry. So the induced map in here, now you look, let's look at the map induced upstairs. This map now takes the complement of this L, which has no symmetry, by Paolizzi and Porti, and then it takes this and this complement of K inside of S1 cross S2, which has no symmetry. So this boundary is a two pieces. Boundary has two pieces, glued along torus, and then each three manifold, outside and inside, has no symmetry. And they're hyperbolic. And the in fact, it's a link. This is really, it's like this. It's a link of some components. It's like this. So therefore, the induced map in here is some map which takes this piece, that piece, and this piece is that inside, the inside, and the outside. So if you have such a diffeomorphism, and by theorem of Jacob Schellen, Johansson, it's called as GSJ theorem, Tarkan manifolds split in these pieces, Gulut along tori, some pieces are cyberfibrous spaces, some pieces hyperbolic, but in this case, I split this manifold, all hyperbolic. Since I'm doing a knot in here, hyperbolic here. And then it takes each piece is an edge piece. Every diffeomorphism such manifold takes pieces to pieces, Jacob Scheele and Johansson. So if it takes this piece to that piece, that piece to that piece, and I know they have no symmetry. This has no symmetry by Paul and Zipporti. This has no symmetry. They're using this programs in S1 process 2. Now that means the induced map upstairs is identity, isotopic to identity. Now you might say, what can it change the pieces? Well, I told you this is actually a link. So with, in our case, it's like a four-component link, like this, and that is not complements like this. So clearly, it has to take this piece to that. It cannot take this piece to that piece because this has many components. So once I know it, any diffeomorphism has to take this piece to that piece, and the other pieces can permute, take to each other. So such diffeomorphism, and they are not symmetries, such diffeomorphism is isotopic identity, because it has to be isotopic identity here. This circle has to go to that circle, that has cos circle, so in here, identity. So then isotopic. So this, I'm describing to you the idea we use with Rubenman to kill the symmetry. In here, the proof we use with Rubenman required to finding invertible knots in S3, which was very difficult to find. But now we have, Eylem gives us every algebraic knot outgoing algebraic, the ones in here, gives invertible concordance. So we use invertible concordance to get this thing, this piece. So where do I use invertible concordance? This is part of the concordance. So I invert this in here. So anyway, let me just imagine this piece. Let me call this piece W1, and this piece W2. So far, I haven't used invertibility. I claim W1, W2 are manifolds homeomorphic, but not diffeomorphic to each other. They cannot be the same. The reason is, I invert this cobordism here. So that means it's like a product in here. And this is identity here. So this part is a product. It's a boundary V cross I. I just put a color in here, boundary V cross I. So if this part was diffeomorphic to that part, then this manifold will be diffeomorphic to that. This manifold will be diffeomorphic to that one. But how do these two manifolds differ? But this part is because it's invertible cobordism. This thing, this is just a product, and this is an invertible cobordism. This is a product in here. All I'm doing is, I have a boundary cross I, boundary cross I, and this is glued by diffeomorphism. So I have a V, and an F, and I have boundary cross I, and this copy is glued by F, this copy glued by identity. So if this manifolds are diffeomorphic, so that means that F extends inside. Because all I did is extended F by identity, trivial cobordism. So that would mean that F will extend inside, which will contradict V being cork. So that's the idea that is used in Rubenman. The hard part here was to choosing a knot in S1 cross S2, which is invertibly concordant to trivial one, which Eylem's theorem supplied to us. Also, hyperbolic complement and no symmetry. So now you look at all possible knots that goes algebraic the ones, check which ones have no symmetry and complements are hyperbolic. For that, so you use these programs, and there's one example in here. So this is an example of a knot in S1 cross S2. This knot, hyperbolic complement, and no symmetry. So after the search, by computer search, you find this knot. So you use this knot in here, in there.
you get two, so you get two manifolds. One is W1, this much, and the other is W2. You get two contractible manifolds, and these two contractible manifolds are absolutely exotic copies of each other. They cannot be diffeomorphic to each other by this trick. If they were diffeomorphic, you do the invertible cobordism. You get one manifold is this, the other manifold is this, and they are both diffeomorphic to V. So that means you are extending the F inside. But now, how do I get this thing Stein? So that's the hard part. So I basically described to you the trick we use with Rubenman to getting absolutely exotic manifolds from the relatively exotic manifolds. In our case, relatively exotic manifold is quark. So to get them Stein, we use this technique. Called roping. So how are these manifolds are obtained? Well, I have a V in here. Inside of V, I need a knot. Which has no symmetry, complement is hyperbolic. So V is the quark. V is in here, and V finds some knot in here. I didn't draw this knot. That's this knot, which I call this L. L in here. So I need to identify that L. I mean, here there's a picture of my V in here also. This is a different contractible manifold. This is a contractible manifold. I mean, this is a knot inside of S1 cross S2. So I need to find L in here. So I would like to glue V. This bond, this piece is the complement of that knot. Complement of that knot in S1 cross S2 has to be glued in the tubular neighborhood of L. So that corresponds to taking this. So this is my quark. This is some knot which we use Rubenman in our paper. So there's some knot in here, no symmetry, and complement is hyperbolic. This is the knot. The computer search gave us with Eylem. So this is not complement, it's hyperbolic, has no symmetry. I need to glue the complement of this to the complement of that. And this technique is called roping. What I need to do is somehow I take, so if you have a three manifold here, this is another three manifold. This is like S1 cross B3 in this case. This is a picture of S1 cross B3. And this is this knot K. Okay, complement no symmetry. And this is my quark. And this is the L. Not given by, or not link, or not given by Paulis and Porti. This is that L in here. So I need to glue. Their complements. I need to glue their complements. The way you do glue complements is this trick. If you have four manifold boundaries, you glue the three manifolds along some diffeomorphisms. The way you glue is you find this three manifold on the boundary has 0, 1, 2, and 3 handles. You look at the one handle circles. So you find the one-handed circles. So this is a diffeomorphism, F. This diffeomorphism. So this is like some knot in here and F of alpha in there. What you do is you attach a two-handle. You want to glue
triple neighborhood of complement of L in here with the complement of L in there. So you are gluing, I mean, this sits inside of S1 cross V3. I need to glue complement of tubular neighborhood of L and complement K and complement tubular neighborhood of L by some diffeomorphism. And that's the technique by roping. So this is how it works. It is in the book. You look at the, one of the sections of the book of four manifolds. So this is K. This is my K. This is a picture. This is a thick circle with one handle and thick circle, really cork. This is V. This is a picture of V. And then I need to find, just cut from in here. This yellow circle is that yellow circle. This yellow circle, which Rubelman, we found this yellow circle, which has no symmetry in the complement, no symmetry in the hyperbolic complement. So that's the yellow knot in here. This is the one we found with Eylem in here. This is that knot in S1 cross B3. We draw it, everything is like Legendrian picture. So this circle, there's this circle, and this circle in here. So we want to identify, we attach a two handle. We connected some of these circles. This is the roping technique tells you. Because there's a circle in here, there's a circle in here, you want to identify them. You just identify, you attach two handle, like a tunnel in there. So this is what is done in here. That's the this is not, I think I call this L in here. I call this L in here, which says gamma in here. This is my L. And this is K in here. So I identify L with K. So here you apply this cork automorphism. L becomes like gamma L. This yellow becomes like this. So thick white ones is the Mason manifold, is a cork, this cork. And then L, tau is I call this F. F is the involution on the boundary of the cork, takes this L to this one, F of L, and you attach a two handle this between these two and the F of L and this two. So in one case, I'm doubling in here with identity, and I'm doubling in here with F after I applied F in there. So this is the picture of two four manifolds you get. So this is Mason manifold and S1 cross B3. S1 cross B3. And inside of this Mason manifold or a cork, I draw a Legendrian curve with this nice property. And I find such a Legendrian curve inside of S1 cross S2. I am drawing like a boundary of S1 cross B3 with that nice property. No symmetry and hyperbolic complements. I attach it to end. I glue. I attach these two things. So the end result is this is one W1. This is W2. Two contractible manifolds. Not diffeomorphic to each other. That's the proof. And now the hard part is to get them to be Stein. To get them to Stein. So you hope that. You after you put this Legendre position, this has large enough TV such that when I connect to something like this and put everything in the Legendre position, TVs will work. So this TV was like 4, and this TV was like -3. I don't remember. Once you do this, then you can get the Thurston-Benikin numbers match in here. So this attaching this two handle is a Legendrian. Stein two handle in here, and this is Stein two handle, this is Stein the handle, this is Stein two handle. Usually when you do this after cork twist, Legendrian curve loses, TV is changed like this one. If you apply this diffeomorphism F, this L becomes like this, F of L. TV of this is -1, TB of this is 0. So you can destroy the property of TB. And here you are lucky that by finding this such a knot, then TBs work right, and then you get both of them Stein manifolds. I mean, I think this the second theorem is more interesting because it uses the similar things, except you have to find this anti-quark involution. So there is, let me tell you maybe two words about that. So we started with a, in this case with a quark involution in here. Here we use anti-quark. So in this case we don't have a contractible manifold. We have a homology S1 cross B3. So this is this thing. This is a slice knot. This is a slice knot, a ribbon knot. Okay, this is inside of the boundary of B4. So you take the K bounds ribbon disk inside of B4. You take the B4 minus the ribbon disk. And this knot. So there's a minus 2 to be seen here. This knot is ribbon in two ways. You can do a ribbon move like this, or you can do a ribbon move like this. This is gamma, and there's an involution technique, F2, like tau of gamma. If you can do this ribbon move, you find one ribbon complement. If you do the other ribbon move, you get the other ribbon complement. But it turns out they are the same ribbon. So this knot bounds two ribbons, diffeomorphic to each other, but the identity on the boundary doesn't extend ribbon complements. So the one, the interesting way to seeing this, a quick way of seeing this, is the following. So you need to find it. So this, you know, two pictures of this. So there's some diffeomorphism in here, taking this this dotted arc to that dotted arc, and then this dotted arc, that dotted arc to this dotted arc, T of gamma and gamma. It's very difficult, so this, I put a dot in here, ribbon complement. It's very hard to see, but if you draw these pictures like that, this picture is, turns out to be equal to this one. This picture is also. So kind of amusing picture. This is both pictures of B4. If you put a circle with dot in here, zero, circle with dot is zero. You change zero and dot exchange in here. Zero in that exchange in there. But you choose a mu in here, and that this is the knot. You do search, computer search, you find that this complement is hyperbolic, is not symmetry. So when I do this involution, which takes gamma to tau of gamma, this looks very complicated, this knot. So you need to see this involution on this homology S1 cross. I mean, this is the picture of B4 minus a ribbon complement in here. So this is a B4. This is a ribbon. You just take a ribbon complement there. You remove that. Easy way of seeing it, you draw this picture like that, such that mu becomes like this.
This is, if you believe it, this picture is the same as that picture is the same as that picture, except there are two circles with dots. These circles, the curve, they bound disk, they are curved. They bound disk, they are curved. But they are, this guy bounds to this. This is gamma and the tau of gamma in here. This is like alpha, this is tau of alpha. And then, like this. These two circles with dots is separate from each other. So they bound two disjoint disks, which you carve out. These two circles with dots are bounding two, they are two separate circles, disjoint from each other. They carve, they bound disks, you carve them out. In one case, there's a two handle in here, the other case, two handle in there. Okay? When you do this, I won't draw this picture of mu in here. Let me not complicate that picture. So, if this picture is same as that picture is the same as that picture. If you cancel this this two handle and this one handle, that circle becomes this knot, this gamma becomes that knot. If you cancel that one handle with that two handle, this circle becomes the same knot. Except you see it, there's an involution, there's a chord twist in here. The difference between that two handle became one handle, zero dot exchange, that two handle become one handle, zero dot exchange. So this becomes dot, zero, zero, dot. When you do that, and then this circle with dot turns into this one or that one. So this whole involution, this anti-quark, we call this anti-quark because that sits inside of a quark. When you do this, the quark disappears. So this undoes the quark complication of the quark. So this is a very beautiful involution. This is really involution of just, if you forget this, just a four ball representing with a circle with a zero, and zero with a circle with that. But when you cancel that, these two carved out circles become one and that one. So you go, you do the same things. You find a knot, and then see, follow this, but it's not. Happens in here. So this is the knot you found, who has no symmetry in complement, has hyperbolic complement, and that one. So this is two pictures of a knot, like a corresponding that picture. You're not going to have a quark, but you are going to have an anti-quark, and it's going to be mu, it's going to be a tau of mu. Yeah, like this. And then you glue that to this to K with the roping technique. So I guess that's all I want to tell you. Thank you very much.